Man, me and my wife got to lead worship at Fields of Faith this past Wednesday, and this is a song we did because it's a mashup of all my favorite worship songs. They asked at the Fields of Faith, which is all middle schoolers and high schoolers, they come together on the football field, and they wanted raw worship instead of lights and stuff and fog machines. Worship is just ascribing worth to God. When I say make sure you worship, I don't mean make sure you get in your car and you sing songs to God. That's part of it. But men, we're going to get focused on today during the message. I hope you know that. But how do you worship God? I think a big way I do is the way I love my wife. In front of you guys, in front of my children, in front of our youth. I describe worth to God because I don't care what she does. I'm going to treat her a specific way. Why? Because I'm supposed to. The word tells me to. It says as a husband, I'm supposed to love her like Christ did the church, sacrificially. Even if she don't deserve love, I'm supposed to give it to her. We can worship God in singing, the way we treat our spouse, the way we raise our kids, the way we drive our cars. I mean, anything, man. A life of worship. Let's just get right into it. I love this part. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. Has you ever chased anybody in the room? No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
We'll cry, these bones we'll say.
Father God, we love you. I know that song says like 50 times that it's your breath in our lungs. But hey, every day it seems like I need to hear it again, God, because I think my life is mine. I do with it what I want. Don't let me leave here today thinking like that. Encourage me, God. Help me be humble, God. Teach me something. Today, me, I'm jealous for your word. Thank you. Thank you for salvation and baptisms that we get to see. Don't let us take that for granted, God. Be with us. Change us. Mold us. We'll give you praise for it, I promise. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys can please be seated.
Hey, I'm Ryan Higgins. I've been going to church here for about 10 months now. Me and my wife started back in February. We have some friends here in the church that got us interested in coming, and we've been coming ever since. So I grew up here in Bainbridge, grew up going on to a church out in Veda, Delwood Baptist, and grew up and got older, and like everybody, kind of drifted away for a while. After high school, I was a crop duster for about 8 years, moved out west, so spent a lot of time on the road and didn't have a whole lot of time in my mind to get back to the church. Fast forward a couple years, I met my wife in 2017, and we have three beautiful kids together. I have five kids total. I have two kids with my past relationship. We started looking for a church a while back. But Jody started working at One Source a little over a year ago, and met Megan up there, Megan Battles, and she's married to Josh Battles, and they're big members of the church here, and they kept harping, like, y'all come on out and see what we're about. At least come give us a test run. So Jody came out one weekend of February. I had to work, so I didn't come with her. And she came back to the house, and she really enjoyed it. And the following week, I came with her, brought the kids. And we have pretty much been every weekend since, within reason, time or two we've missed. I really enjoyed everything about the church. I've enjoyed the atmosphere. I don't feel pressured for anything at all. I don't understand a lot of this stuff, but it comes a little easier the way Laddie helps break it down, more layman terms. I can understand that better than I can somebody just preaching verses to me and not really elaborating on a whole lot more. The kids enjoy, I've got the older two boys are in Upstreet. The younger kids, they're here in the nursery. And all I hear about when they leave is how much fun they had, what they learned, and how they can't wait to come back. My oldest two boys don't live with me, but I've had both of them tell me how they're gonna go home and try to get the mom to come too, because they want to be able to come every weekend. We've started doing a small group on Wednesdays. We're with Hunter and Megan Boyd, and Josh and Megan Battles there as well as several others, and that gives another aspect to it, and I enjoy getting to do that as well. Learning a lot more about myself, about my wife, about us together, because we do have five kids, so we don't get a whole lot of time to just each other anymore. So those Wednesday nights are nice to come home and reflect when the kids are in bed and see what we learned about. I've been thinking about getting baptized for probably the last 2 years. So when we met Josh, me and him hit it off a lot. I fish a lot of bass tournaments. I guide fishing trips in the lake. So me and him clicked there with that. We fished a couple tournaments together this year, and we ended up on the Flint River one evening in June. I've got a buddy of mine that we used to fish a lot of bass tournaments with, and he has a specific place down in the lake that we named after him. He passed away last year in a tragic accident. Me and Josh are fishing, and we're talking about life and about God and this and that, and next thing I know, we're on my buddy's point, and the sun's setting, and everything just seemed right. So me and Josh, we put the rods down for a minute, we had a talk, and that's where I accepted God as my Savior. And after talking to Josh a little more, he's like, you need to see about, when you get comfortable, letting Laddie set up a baptism for you. We finally put a weekend down, and I couldn't be more excited. I've been waiting on this for a long time. I want my kids to see what my faith is and what I believe in. But I want them to see what it's done for me, it's done for my marriage. It's completely turned my life around in every way. Since June, don't get me wrong, I still trip and stumble every now and then, everybody does. But since June, that night with me and Josh, I've noticed there's been pretty big turnaround in a lot of things. Class seems to be a lot more half full these days than half empty. I find myself praying a lot more when I used to feel like oh crap, man, you need to stop and pray about this. Instead, now I just find myself talking to God, driving down the road, and things just make a lot more sense now. I don't know how to really put it into words, but life in general seems to be going pretty good. So I do want to thank, my wife for sticking by my side. I've been a knucklehead sometimes, and you deserve a lot better than what I have been. I want to thank you for helping me through this. It's not very easy for me to try new things, but you make it seem a whole lot easier. I'm pretty hard-headed, and you know that, but thank you for standing beside me and not pushing me, but at the same time still being the rock that I need to make me pick up my feet and follow through with things. I also want to thank Josh and Megan. Megan, first off, you've been a fantastic friend to Jody. She thinks the world of you. I do as well. You, whether you know it or not, are a big part of this process. You talking to her and her talking to me and me talking to Josh, our circle has come in some weird way to where we've all become real good friends, and I wouldn't have it any other way. I appreciate everything you do for Jody. I appreciate what you do for my kids and for myself. And I appreciate the conversations we've had about faith to where you opened my eyes on some things that I still don't understand fully. And Josh, I really appreciate you helping me understand and explain everything that you have. While you don't know it all, regardless of what you think, you've helped me learn a lot, and I'm very thankful for our friendship. I'm glad that our wives crossed paths so we could cross paths. I'm looking forward to teaching you how to fish as you've taught me more about God and my faith. So thanks for everything you've done, man. And I'm really looking forward to where we go from here. My name is Ryan Higgins, and I just want to let everybody know that Jesus is my Lord and Savior.
I don't think I'm on yet. There I am. So, one, you're going to talk about how I fish, and then you're going to let me put you underwater. All right. You should have thought that through a little bit more. Man, this is awesome. I remember that day. It means a lot to me to be here. Man, that light is bright. But it's an honor to do this. I was wondering what I was going to say, but you said it all. Ladies, just to let y'all know, we do other things when we go fishing. It's not just fishing. That's right. We do talk, see? Let him go fishing more often. I was talking to Daddy this week. We went to lunch, and I couldn't think of anything to say and told him your story, and he brought it up. A verse in Psalms that says, "Be still and know that I am God." And that's what it was. We were still. The water was perfect. Sunset. And here we are, man. So, everything's worked out. Thank you for being my friend. Thank your wife, your family. It means so much to us. But with that, I don't do feelings, so I'm going to baptize this man. So with that being said, man, I now, with your profession of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You got to come down some. Yeah, buddy. Absolutely.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Can we go to that next light cue, Eden? Thank you. Wrap up that towel. Then. All right, that's enough. That's enough. All right, come on. Come on over here. Ryan, what a story, man. It was a privilege to get to video that, and had Desperado in the background. Just thought you, yeah. So anyway, just one more time, y'all. Would y'all give Ryan a hand for his decision? Yeah, okay. All right. So listen, if you contribute in any way to Bamer Church, if you serve, if you give, whatever, you're a part of that story. You're part of all the stories of baptism that we get to see around here and people deciding to give their life over to Jesus. And what an amazing story where Josh just thought, you know, they might be just going to catch some fish. Little did he know that he was part of a process where God was teaching him to be a fisher of men. And Josh is an elder here, and that's a really big deal that our leaders lead, and they lead well. And Ryan now stepping up saying, listen, I'm going to lead my family well. I want my kids to see me live out my faith. What a beautiful thing. So let's pray, and then we're going to jump into part two of Imperfect Family. Father, thank you so much for this story, and thank you for letting Bamer Church be a small part of what you're doing in Ryan and Jody's life and the rest of what you're going to continue to write into this beautiful, beautiful story. We love you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Now, home is a lot of work, just plain work.
When work at home is planned and organized for cooperation, there can usually be more time for leisure.
I'm certainly in favor of those things. Leisure, fun.
Who is it?
Wouldn't we all be happier if we worked out a little system for living together in harmony?
But how can we manage them?
We'll have to work out the full answer together.
Say, Mom, you're swell.
Problems can be solved through frank and friendly discussion, which points the way to a happy family life.
You know, this is beginning to be quite a family project.
It certainly is.
All right, so last week we started this series called Imperfect Family by talking to the wives. And as I shared, I have never approached a sermon with more fear and trepidation in my entire life. And so thank you to the ladies in the room who are very gracious and kind to me in your responses after the service. Didn't receive any threatening emails, so I consider that a big win. I know that it's a difficult subject matter to talk about when you're not living in the ideal. So when you know you're going through a divorce or you're widowed or all, I know this is difficult to talk about in the middle of that. And so, you know, we're, like I said last week, there's just a lot of grace in the middle of that situation, and we're here to help in any way that we can as you go through that. Today we're talking to the husbands. And so last week I said to all the men in the room, because we're talking to wives, if you're not an amen kind of guy, Don't start today. Like, this is not the day to be amen. And when I'm talking to the women. And so, ladies, if you're not an amen kind of lady, then maybe don't do it today, okay? Just kind of sit there, maybe take some notes, okay? I heard that. We're gonna abide by the same rules today as we jump into the topic of husbands. We're going to be in Ephesians chapter 5, and so if you have a Bible, you can go there, and we're going to be changing gears a little bit there. But in order to talk about Ephesians 5, 23, 24, 25, we gotta look at verse 20 first. And so I wanna make sure that we start there. So right here, and this is how we started last week, always giving thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to God, even the Father, that Paul is writing to this church and trying to lay down a foundation for what the family should look like under Jesus. And the very first thing he wants to make mention of in the context is be thankful. Be thankful. And so, husbands, let me go ahead and ask you, when is the last time you prayed for your wife? Prayed for your wife, not about your wife. We all pray about our wives. God, if you don't do something with her, I'm gonna, okay? Now, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about praying for. I'm talking about being thankful for. I'm talking about spending time on your knees to your Creator and saying, thank you, God, that you allowed me an opportunity to love her and serve her well. By the way, one more caveat, I want to make sure, because I see a lot of faces, and there are a lot of couples, a lot of married couples, but there are single people in the room as well. And so I want to say to you, single folks, if you're a single guy, you should be taking lots of notes, okay? Because this is what you want your spouse to be looking for in you, your future spouse. So guys, taking notes. All the single ladies, okay, y'all need to be no one. No one born in the 90s? No, all right, anyway, single ladies, take notes because you want to be praying that your husband has these qualities, that your future husband looks like what we're going to be talking about today. Okay, so this doesn't exclude you. Don't check out on me. Start writing these things down. Guys, if you didn't bring a piece of paper in here, I'm going to make fun of you. Okay, just be ready. I'm going to talk about it, okay? And so you should be writing, taking notes, okay? So anyway, all right, so when is the last time you prayed for your wife, not about her? Need to be focused on that. Moving on to the next verse. And this always gets confused. Remember we talked about last week, Ephesians 5:22, wives submit to your husbands. And we love to talk about that. In fact, that's a lot of you ladies, that's your life verse. You sing it every morning. I get it. That word's not in there. It's here. It starts here. Submit is here. And it applies to everybody. That marriage is a submission competition. It's you first, no you first, no you first, no you first. It's over and over and over. And we said last week that is what a good friendship looks like. Your best friend in the world is going to put your needs and wants and desires above theirs. And they're just going to constantly do things for you. And it feels uncomfortable how comfortable they are by putting themselves last. And that is a great friendship. And that is what a great marriage looks like as well. It should be uncomfortable. How many times you're just trying to say you first, baby, no, you first, baby, no, you first, baby, over and over and over again. It's a submission competition. Submit means to consider others as more important than yourselves. Jumping into a question that kind of helps us understand this. How can I leverage all of me to what benefits you the most? This is a question I need to ask of myself for my wife. How can I leverage whatever I have to give that will benefit her the most? It's a great question. All right, next. Verse 21, and submit to one another in the fear of Christ. Wives, be subject to your own husbands as to the Lord. As we said in the original, that's not in there. It's referring back to the last one. It just says, wives, be to your own husbands as to the Lord. So we know what it means, which means it also applies to the husband. So don't say that's just for her. It's for you too. Now we get in. Now this part is still talking to the wives, but it describes what a husband's supposed to look like. A godly Christian, Jesus-following husband. Now, the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is also head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. That you, gentlemen, you, husband, are the head. That means you take full responsibility for every single thing that happens in the house. Full responsibility. Well, what about, you know, PTA meetings and making sure lunch is packed? You take responsibility. Now, what if you decide beforehand, hey, I'll take care of that if you take care of this? It's fine. Still your responsibility. Even if she's doing it, it automatically, the buck stops at you. You are responsible for the whole thing. And what we see in the life of Jesus is that he took full responsibility for the church, that he is the head of the church, and he didn't do anything wrong. Not one thing. The most innocent person that ever lived. Yet he looked at the body of Christ, he looked at the Christians, those that would believe in him, and he's like, I didn't do anything wrong, but you did. And so I'm going to take full responsibility for your actions, and I'm going to pay the price for you. And he's saying that is exactly what a husband should do for their wife. Even if you didn't feel responsible for whatever fell through the cracks, you are responsible for it. You take full responsibility for it. If you're going to be a head, be a good one. Take all responsibility. You're on the hook for it all anyway. You might as well leverage your gifts for her benefit. It is a great and noble task, gentlemen, that you have been assigned to, that I've been assigned to be the husband of a wife, to be the father to my children. It is an amazing, noble task. Now, she continues on here, but as the church is subject to Christ, so also the wives ought to be to their husbands and everything. We already talked about that. Then here we get into the meat of it. Husbands. Now, you would expect after he just said, as Christ did this, husbands this, and you would expect him to say, husbands, so lead. I've told you, you're the head, lead. You're going to serve, lead. But that is not the word that he uses here. He uses a much more important, powerful, and humbling word. He says, husbands, love your wives. If you go to the next slide. Love your wives. Husbands, love your wives. This is an interesting word, love. There's three Greek words for this word in your Bible. One is eros. That's where we get the word erotic from. It means intimate. It means special. It means sexual in nature. It means this closeness, this physical closeness. That's eros. That is not this word. There is another word in the Greek for love, and it is phileo. It means brotherly love. And both of these words are found in a healthy marriage, the eros and the phileo. But that is not the word he's using here. This is the word, the Greek word agape. This word agape means unconditional love, and it is the exact same word used in John 3:16. For God so agaped the world that he sent his one and only son. And it's the same word used of husbands to their wives. You should agape your, but what if she, that word takes all that out. There is no what if she. It's agape. It means unconditional. But what about doesn't matter. You can't win the argument. Husbands, agape your wives. It is a high calling. So then you may say, okay, how much? I get that it's a lot, but I mean, how much? Well, if we're going to use Jesus as the example, it's until it costs you everything. But don't I get? Nope. But don't I? Nope. No. If you've stepped into this world we call Christian, if you decided that Jesus is your Lord and Savior, and you've decided to marry one of his princesses, you have to love her until it costs you everything. Well, that doesn't seem very fair. Doesn't have to be fair. Is what Jesus went through fair? Isn't it interesting that when fair is put on the table, love almost always leaves? It's not about fair. It's about this unconditional calling to love the people God has put in our lives well. So listen, let me just poke here a little bit. When can I divorce her? You might be thinking, if I'm supposed to love that, when can I divorce her? Here's a clue. You can divorce her when Jesus divorces you. You're like, but what about, Don't use those allowances that are given to people who you know, had these issues or whatever. No. So husbands, I'm just talking to husbands. When can you decide that you don't love her anymore? You can't. You're in. It's not a contract. You don't get to sign your way out of it. The only way out of the covenant that you made with your spouse is death. That's it. So, this is just scripture. This is just truth. When can I stop loving her? When Jesus stops loving you. I mean, pretty self-explanatory. You can take that as far as you want, but I mean, if you try to find any loophole in it, there isn't a loophole. You've been called to love her the way that Christ loves the church. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her. So then I started teasing this out, thinking, what does this actually look like? What are some ways we've seen Christ love the church, and how do we put that into our relationships with our wife? So let's just throw out a few of them. So how did Christ love the church? Number one, he pursued her. The Bible teaches us that long before we ever looked to him, long before we ever thought we even knew we needed a Savior, that God in Christ pursued us, chased after us, sought after us, that he came to seek and to save the lost. So what does a husband do? He seeks, he pursues her. God pursued you, you don't stop pursuing her. But hey, this morning, Pastor, she didn't wake up very pursuable. I'm with you, brother. I understand, okay? I get it. It happens. You know what? You wake up unpursuable every day to Jesus. Yet he seeks you out anyway. It doesn't, like, you got to just put that to the side and just keep on pursuing her, keep on chasing after her, keep on showing her value. What is another thing that Jesus does? Well, he lavishes love on the church, like not just a little bit, not just enough, but scripture tells us in 1 John 3:1, see with what love the Father lavishes on his children. That word means there's so much, it's spilling out all over the place. Like it's just excess love. Gentlemen, if I went into your phone and looked at all the texts that you send to your wife, let's say I went through 100, and I were to summarize your your written word communication with the person that Jesus puts in your life for you to care for, take care of, and provide for, what would I walk away with? Would I walk away with 90% commands, 90% expectations? Would I walk away with a lot of these do's and don'ts, or would I walk away feeling, I don't know anything else, but that dude is lavishing her with love? That's just one example of many ways you can kind of pick this apart. Give her your all. It's the thought of, I will do with less so that you can have more. Jesus took the full price for something that was not his fault, and we need to love our wives that way. Lavish love on her. Number three, how did Christ love the church? Inexhaustible forgiveness. I'm sorry for those of you English teachers, you're probably thinking there's supposed to be an E in there. I'm imperfect. Inexhaustible forgiveness. By the way, since I could say that for that, listen, I am not standing up here telling y'all that I've got this thing figured out. My wife is serving in that room right over there. You can ask her. She's got a list this long of how I don't pull this off. But y'all need to know I'm trying, okay? I'm trying. My mother-in-law's here too. She's back there. And so, you know, I want her to see me love her daughter well. And so I'm trying, okay? I don't have this all figured out. I've been with the same woman for 26 years. And for the last 2 weeks, man, I've been putting all this into practice, okay? Like, I'm all in now, okay? I'm doing it. Inexhaustible forgiveness. Inexhaustible forgiveness. Colossians 2 says that there is now, therefore, no record of debt, that it has been nailed to the cross. Husbands, do not keep a record of wrongs. I don't know about y'all, but usually when there's a fight, someone fights hysterically, someone fights historically. Well, remember in 2002 when you said this, when you did this, okay, don't do that. Guys, there is no record of wrongs. Do not ever bring up the past ever. It's childish. It's childish, okay? Children thrive and live and make decisions off of emotions. Adults develop a plan and stick to it. The plan is you don't bring up the past anymore. You love her exactly how she is, right where she is, no matter what. You love her with an inexhaustible forgiveness, no matter what she throws at you, because that is how Jesus loves you. Here's a tough one. Jesus crucified his will for the church. Amen? Crucify your will for her. There's this moment in the Garden of Gethsemane where Jesus is there. He's weeping. He's broken. His body is crying and praying so hard that the capillaries under his skin is busting. And he's sweating drops of blood because he doesn't want to go to the cross. And his will is, Father, if there's any other way, if Allah can get them there, if Hinduism can get them there, if good works can get them there, can you figure out another way? Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Husbands, crucify your will for your wife. You might not get what you want, and that's okay. He wanted one thing and did something completely different for his bride. It's not about you. It's what's best for her. Here's another one. And by the way, this is not a complete list. We could be here for days, okay? This is just a few. He served her. Do you remember when Jesus, it was right at the night when he was supposed to have the communion, he did have the communion supper with his disciples. He took off his outer garments, got down on his knees, and he washed the disciples' feet. And it was so offensive and it was so gross that Peter was like, whoa, you are not washing my feet. And Jesus was like, hold up, if you don't let me wash your feet, like I'm not here to be served, I'm here to serve. And then Peter's like, okay, well then wash my whole body. And then Jesus is like, okay, just got weird, you take your own bath. I'm not bathing you. I'm just washing feet here. Now, what does this look like practically? I mean, you can go, you need to wash her feet, literally, okay? You need to take care of her, wash her feet. You need to do the thing in the house that no one else wants to do, okay? Remember that time when y'all had shrimp and the bottom of the bag of the trash can had a hole in it and the shrimp juice went into the bottom and then, you know, you pulled the bag up and that smell hit you in the face or whatever? And then what'd you do, guy? I know what you did. You put the bag back on and said, she'll get it. I know, okay? I am one. I've been there. You don't do that. You know what you do? You take that thing outside, you scrub it, you get in it, and you get all, I mean, you make it so clean. That thing smells like it was brand new. Baby, I did this for you. Look at that. It's all clean. I took care of it all for you. You scrub the toilet. You do all the stuff. You serve her. The thing that she says, you go to her and you say, hey, listen, how can I help? What can I do for you today? She said, I do not want to fold laundry. Boom. You're like, I'm going to fold the mess out of this laundry because I'm going to show you how much I love you. I'm going to fold this laundry. Like, that is what it looks like to serve your spouse. You serve her the way Jesus served us. We don't react, gentlemen, we respond in love. Could you imagine if Jesus reacted to every single one of your sins when you committed them? I mean, just as God perfect and all, if he just decided to just, you know what, I'm putting all the grace, all the forgiveness, I'm putting all that aside, I'm just going to react with my wrath. Could you imagine? He never does that. He doesn't react that way. He responds in love. We're called to do the exact same thing. As I was thinking about this, and very humbled, by the way, by reading this and looking at my life and how I'm supposed to be an example, this thought came to my mind. Few things reveal, and I'll say it in first person, few things reveal my need for Jesus like my inability to love my bride the way he loves me. Few things reveal your need for Jesus like your inability to love your bride like he loves us. There are a lot of things that show me how I fail, but when I look at her and what he has done for me and how I should treat her based on that, I am broken every single time. Now, chapter 5, verse 26. So that, this is, you're going to serve her, you're going to love her, and he's talking, he's telling his parallel story of how Jesus loves the church and how husbands supposed to love their bride. So that, why is he doing all, why is he serving her, loving her this way? So that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that Jesus is sanctified. That word means make holy. That he is making holy his church, making holy his bride by cleansing her and washing the water of the word. And as I was looking at this, I'm like, okay, how does this apply to what we're doing? And really what it means is to take responsibility and lead your home in holiness, gentlemen. Myself included, we need to be leading our home in what it looks like to live a sanctified life. And then in so doing, we are cherishing and loving and nourishing our family, our wives, and thus showing her value. We need to lead in holiness. So what does that look like? Well, be an example of the sanctification. Be the leader. So we need to be the lead repenter. No one in your house should say, I'm sorry more than you. Gentlemen, no one in your house should say, I'm sorry more than you. You should be the lead repenter. If it's been months since you said, I'm sorry, something's wrong. Go ahead and ask your spouse, when's the last time you said you're sorry? And whatever she says, believe her. And then make sure that never happens again. You should ask forgiveness. You should out say, I'm sorry more than anyone else in your home, including your children. If you have never apologized to your children, you're doing something wrong because there's no way you've been perfect the entire time. And your children deserve to hear you say, I'm sorry. Be the lead thanker. No one should say thank you more in your home than you, gentlemen. No one. You thank for everything. That was an amazing meal. Thank you. So, thank you so much for folding my clothes. Thank you so much for cleaning the house. Thank you so much for loving our children. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. No one should out-thank you, gentlemen. You should be saying thank you for everything till it gets ridiculous. No one should out-thank you. You should be the lead disciple. This one's difficult. We've somehow got into this. I don't know when it happened exactly. Maybe when the lazy boy came out and, you know, lunch boxes and all this stuff. I don't know. But way back in the day, there came a moment where all of a sudden the women became responsible, or at least felt the weight of responsibility for the spiritual leadership and formation of their home. And men checked out. It's time to check back in, gentlemen. You are the lead disciple in your home. You need to feel the responsibility of what your children believe to be good and right and true about Jesus. You should be the one leading them to Christ. They should see the example in you. You should be the one most concerned about how often you attend church. If it should not ever be this, well, if nothing else is going on and all my clothes are clean and I don't have something scheduled already, listen, if you're a follower of Jesus, that never enters the equation. What do we do on Sunday? My kids used to ask, what do we do on Sunday? What do you think we're doing Sunday? That's my, what do you think we're doing? We're going to church. Like, it's not even an option. When we go on vacation, where are we on Sunday morning? We're in church. You don't ever have to ask my kids. This is what we do. I even like to pull the Duraco card. We're Duracos. This is what Duracos do. Okay, we go to church. All right? Feel free to steal that if you want. But I mean, this, it needs to be a part of who you are. It needs to be the DNA. And gentlemen, you're on the hook for it. You better take the full weight of the responsibility for this. Be the lead disciple. You should be the most concerned about your wife's relationship with Jesus, the most concerned about your kids' relationship with Jesus. This whole thing, you know, I don't really know the Bible. I don't really understand it. Learn it. Okay, we just spent 34 weeks in the book of Romans. You can get online at any time and go through that. In fact, we now live in a day, gentlemen, where you can watch any of your favorite communicators in the world at any given time. You don't have to go to another church. You can go anywhere at any time and listen to the best preaching you've ever heard on your phone. There has never been less of an excuse to know your Bible and to know it well. and to lead in your home. Learn it. Do you know how much dumb stuff you learn for the work you work, the job you do? You know how much dumb stuff you learn for that? But yet, oh, I don't know the Bible. I don't really, you know, I'm not going to really, you know, I'll leave that to the professionals. You're the professional in the house. You're the priest. You are the one to be leading your home spiritually. Know and read the scriptures. Number four, be the lead sacrificer. It should be obvious to those that know us that we hand our life to those around us. It should be obvious to everyone around us that we are lead sacrificer in the family. So here's the deal. When you come in the door at 5, 5:30, 6, 6:30, 7, 7:30, 8, 8:30, all you need to know is you're stepping into second shift. That's it. It's second shift. Okay? It's not, oh, well, I work today, so let me, you know, check out. Let me get into my chair. Let me pop this thing back and let me get, you know, something to drink. That is not the way this works. When you step in the home, you step in the door, it is second shift. It's take off the shirt and tie and put on some clothes and be ready to serve your heart out until it's bedtime. It's second shift. This is the way, and we are the lead sacrificer in the home and should be. Another issue that I see, and I'm guilty of, is that we have the potential, men, to give the very best of ourselves to the people that we spend time with from 8 to 5 and the people that we are called to love get the leftovers from 5 to 11. And that is an embarrassing thought, that someone who will replace you in a heartbeat because they're going to ask for a little bit less money and they will not grieve you not being there anymore, but we're going to give that person our level best and bring leftovers home to the people who love us unconditionally? What are we doing? If you're going to cheat, and you will cheat, gentlemen, if you're going to cheat, you cheat work. You cheat your boss. You don't cheat your kids, and you don't cheat your wife. If you're going to skip out, if you're going to skimp, if you're going to cheat, you cheat work. You'll find another job. But you don't have another wife. You don't have any other kids. Those are it forever and ever, amen. And they better know that they take precedence over that 8 to 5. You need to be the lead sacrificer. Pray for her. You say, I don't pray out loud. I don't care. Here's the deal. You're a guy, learn to pray out loud. You've given speeches before at work. You've talked to people. You've talked to more than two people in a room. You can pray out loud. Learn it. Practice it. Do it over and over and over again. Do not give the excuse. Listen, if you'll learn something you've never done before and embarrass yourself in front of people and you'll do it for money, you can do this for love. She's worth it. You pray for her, and you pray for her out loud, and you let her hear your heart to your sovereign creator about how amazing she is and how broken you are. You let her hear that, and it will open up an area of your relationship you didn't even know existed, because it is only on that battlefield that you can fight for her heart. You can fight for her physically anywhere, but it's only in that battlefield of being on your face before your God that you can fight for her heart, and there are things coming after her heart, and you better not be left standing on the sidelines. You better be right up front, chest out. You can't get to her unless you come through me. Let's see, other ways we can be sacrificial. Talk about the sermons at home. Write something down, guys. Like, this is super simple. You come to, by the way, the majority of people who take notes in church are ladies. I don't know if y'all know that. You probably do. But it's the majority of the people, and guys rarely ever take notes. And so I just want you to try this one. You don't even have to write a lot. You could just write one word, okay? Like, could you imagine how amazing it would be? You just write down one word. Say today. You go home, and you wrote down agupe. Like, you don't even spell it right. You don't even know what you're saying. You're like, hey, baby, how about that sermon today? How about that agupe? And then she's going to be like, okay, he said agape. And you can be like, okay, yeah, let's talk about that. And then all you got to do is that, and then she's going to talk for a long time. And then at the end, you're going to say, hey, I'm right with you, baby. You're exactly right. And you will have just had maybe the most deep theological discussion you've ever had with your spouse before, and you started it. And it will be amazing. And that will just be step one of many, many conversations that could happen in the future where you may jump in and be involved. Take notes. If it's important, if it's something you want to change in your life, make sure that you're keeping track of it. And it is a process, gentlemen. Subdue and cultivate, which is the very first command of God given to Adam. He's like, I want you to take this earth. I want you to subdue it and cultivate it. Adam's like, sweet, I got the subdue part. I don't know how to cultivate anything. And here we all are. We all know how to subdue. We can subdue anything. But what is cultivation? Cultivation is taking care of each individual little plant in your garden. It's looking at this one. This one needs to be weeded. This one needs to be watered. This one needs attention. This one. And we don't know how to do all of that. Gentlemen, tend to the garden of your marriage. It is not her job to do all of it. Make sure you're paying attention to all of it. Work harder for the woman in your home than the boss at work, because one day someone else is going to be doing your job. You are your wife's only husband, your kid's only father. If you're going to cheat something, cheat work. And as I was going through this, we'll finish this verse up. So that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water of the word. As I read this, I thought, what this does is it shows me how valuable I am to Jesus. That not only did he didn't have to do anything else. He didn't have to do anything. But not only did he teach and give amazing things that help us live life, he not only did miraculous things and still does, he not only paid for the penalty for our sin, but he is doing everything to give us an amazing life now, an abundant life, Scripture teaches in John 10, that we're not just to have life, but have it abundantly because of what Christ has done for us. And that shows me how valuable I am to him. Husbands, she better not ever question her value. Ever. We'll just put this up here. She never needs to question her value. Never, 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 never. You say, well, how do I do that? Value her with your eyes. She is your only standard of beauty forever. There is no one hotter, gentlemen. No one. But what about, no. She's your standard of beauty. She is there is no one. There is no one more funny. There is no one more beautiful. There is no one more appealing. There is no one that works harder. There is no one better than the one that you have beside you in your home. She is everything. You value her with her eyes. You don't look at anything else. Whether it's a video, a picture, or someone live, you don't look at them. Every time you do that, you devalue her. Don't believe me? Ask her. There should be nothing else vying for your visual attention than your spouse. Value her with her with your mouth. There better not be another person on this planet out complimenting her. You better make sure that she knows and feels her value every single day. Don't let another man out compliment you to your wife. Value her with your hands. When you reach out for her, does she think automatically he wants something from me or he's giving something to me? Boys take, men serve. What's her first thought when you reach out? And value her with your time. Don't give her the leftovers. Choose your hobby wisely. Notice I said hobby, not hobbies, on purpose. You only get one. You don't need more than that. And let her tell you when's enough enough. Don't ever get to the point where she has to tell you to stop. Get to the point where she says to you, you haven't gone golfing enough. You should go golfing. You haven't been fishing enough. You should go fishing. Let her tell you that. That's when you know you're on the right track. If she has to say to you, it's been a lot. It's been a lot, babe. It's time to take a break. You've gone too far. Don't need to do that. Let value her with your time. Let's see. How can I help? You need to ask her that all the time. How can I help? Let's see. Verse 27. This one messed me up. You're talking about Jesus in the church. That Jesus might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and blameless. That one day, Jesus is going to take the church for whom he died and paid the price and then did everything necessary to make sure that she is this beautiful entity. He will present it. And as I was thinking about this, I was thinking, man, oh man, I hope my wife goes first. Because there is no greater thing in my life that I can imagine than the two of us living another 30, 40, 50 years together. And as we've spent all that time together, and now she's puking all over the place. And I'm changing her diaper. And I'm answering the same question 62 times because she forgot she asked it 61 times. And I'm doing so with the exact same grace the first time she asked it to the very last time. And I'm wiping the drool off her mouth. And I'm taking care of every single thing that she needs. And then one day she breathes her last. And I get to hold her and hand her to Jesus and say, thank you for letting me care for her. That's the goal. That's the hope. That's the prayer. That's what Jesus is doing for each and every person in his body. And that is what men we should be, how we should be treating our spouse. Just serving until you enter into those gates broken, hardly able to carry her, having paid everything yourself. You're like, that's too much. I agree. It is. Nevertheless, it's the standard. It just is. So, verse 28, Husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself. I'm looking at that and I'm going, this is an interesting verse because I've never really met a man who doesn't love himself. Okay, there's some guys who self-deprecate a little, but at the end of the day, ladies, y'all know this. He's getting out of the shower, walks by the mirror. What does he do? Man, I still got it, man. I'm looking good. Big old belly, you know what I'm saying? Like, but it don't matter. The guy's like, hey. And we know how to take care of ourselves, guys. Let's not fool the ladies. We do. We know how to get what we want and keep her from knowing about it. Okay? You know you want to go by that gas station and get the Diet Mountain Dew in the Reese cup, and you want to make sure she don't know that you did it before dinner. And so what do? You go to Walmart, you buy the groceries, you get $20 cash. And then that way you spend the cash, and she never sees that you spent $6. Listen, am I giving it away? I'm sorry. Y'all be patient with your men as they're trying to figure this out, all right? But listen. Love your wives as you love you, and you know how to love you well. And you'll find creative ways to love you. So you love her. Okay, you want some examples. Let me give you some examples. You're leaving for work and you're thinking of stopping by the gas station to get a Mountain Dew and a Reese cup. Text her and see what she wants you to bring her. You're making yourself a sandwich at lunchtime on Saturday before the game. Ask her if you can make her something. You're stopping by Walmart on your lunch break. Ask her if she needs anything. You're out and about and on your way home. Text her and ask her if she wants a coffee. You take care of you and find creative ways to do it. Apply those same thoughts to her. You're an expert at taking care of you. Become an expert at taking care of her. Become a student. Do you know how many guys I know can quote me and tell me the most ridiculous stats about Major League Baseball players and college football players, but don't know squat about the woman that they're supposed to love? Become a student of her. Like, learn her, know her. Know what makes her smile. And when you see that hidden smile, and gentlemen, you know what I'm talking about, that smile that you only get to see and no one else gets to see, find out what you did that made it happen and do it again. Like, find way, be an expert on your wife and love her well. Nourish and cherish her. Verse 29 here and 30. For no one has ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ also does the church, because we are members of his body. Nourish and cherish. These are amazing words. This just means to take care of, but cherish means to keep warm. Keep her close. Like, make sure that she knows you're it, that she's it for you. Make sure that all of that is true. And then I had to throw this in here, because as I'm going through this, I'm like, I just got to make sure I say this out loud. Because the whole calling here, if you're in a relationship and you're not saved, gentlemen, if you are not a follower of Jesus, I don't know how to tell you how to be married. I just don't. Because really all you're engaged in is a personality battle. And the hope is that your personalities will stay in check, hopefully for the rest of your lives. But what ends up happening, if you don't have Jesus in the middle of it, is one personality is going to go one way, the other one's going to go the other way. All of a sudden, the grass is greener on the other side, and, oh, I met my soulmate, whatever that means, and you divorce the person that God put you with. And it's like, what are we even doing? Just because your personalities clash, you don't love her anymore. You don't get to vacate. You don't get to move on. So if you're not a believer, I don't know how to tell you to be married. But if you are a believer, this is the standard, gentlemen. 1 Timothy 5:8 says, if anyone does not provide for his own and especially for those of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Called to provide for your household, and especially for those in your own home, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever if you do not provide for those in there. So let me just go ahead and make a blanket statement. Be mad at me, send me an email if you want, but if you refuse to love your wife the way that Christ loved the church, please stop calling yourself a Christian. Because you're giving us that are really trying a bad name. If you say you're a follower of Jesus, mean it and live it out. And when you fail and when you fall, and you will, you apologize and you repent and you go again. And you just keep going and you just keep loving and you just keep giving. But if you refuse to do this in any capacity and just do whatever you want, please do us all a favor. And take the Jesus follower words out your mouth, because you're not living it. He goes on in verse 31, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and shall be joined to his wife, and the two become one flesh. This inexplicable thing that we can't control, you become one with the other person forever and ever. It just is. And in fact, Paul calls it a mystery in the very next verse. He says, this mystery is great, but I'm speaking with reference to Christ and the church, in the same way that Christ and the church have become one, and the same way that the Trinity is one. When you make a covenant with another human being, you become one. And it is this mystery. But it happens, it's true, and every one of you have felt it, because you're still connected to that person that you were intimate with in some way. You pull everyone into your life. That person that you cheated on, your wife that you're now with, when you were 15, 16, and 17, they're still there. There's still a shadow. There's still a conversation. They're always there, because when you get intimate with somebody else, you become one, and it never fully and finally disappears. It's always there, which is why if you are single, if you are young, if you have not married yet, listen to me carefully. I'm not trying to throw the Bible at you. That's not necessary. When you think about the person you're going to marry, you need to make sure whoever you're dating is that person that you might marry, because whoever you have sexual intimacy with before, then you are cheating on your future spouse with them. You are already having an affair before you ever get married. Don't do it. Just wait. Chase after Jesus with everything you got, and then you're going to find another person chasing after Jesus with all that they got. And while y'all are one and full-fledged toward Jesus, look to them and say, hey, how you doing? That's what you do. That's how you find them. That's how you find her, okay? All right, next. Nevertheless, each individual among you is also to love his own wife even as himself, and the wife must see to it that she respects her husband. I know I'm going over. Give me a couple of minutes and we're done. 1 Corinthians 3:11, 13:11 says, when I was a child, I used to speak like a child, think like a child, reason like a child. When I became a man, I did away with childish things. When you read this verse, you think, what is he talking about? He must be talking about theology stuff. He must be talking about praying more. He must be talking about reading the Bible. He's not talking about any of those things. When Paul talks about what it looks like to be a child or a man, he's talking about love. You back up a few verses. Love is patient. Love is kind. It is not jealous. It does not brag. And it is not arrogant. It does not act unbecomingly. It does not seek its own. It is not provoked. It does not take into account a wrong suffered. It does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth. Bears all things. Love believes all things. Love hopes all things and endures all things. Love never fails. To be a boy is to not love. To be a man is to love and to love well. Every year, I take my wife out on a date. We go on lots of dates, okay? But every year, we go on one date that is specific. I find the sitter. I make the reservation. I take care of everything. And on that date, I ask her questions. I don't know how helpful it has been for her, but it has been really helpful for me. These are the questions that I ask her. What can I do to love you better? Some years, it's a long answer. Some years, there's none. Some years, it's like, hey, we're doing good. Everything's good. Some years, it's a long answer. But just by asking the question, it lets her know that I know I'm not there yet and I want to give you everything you deserve. Number two, what can I do to love our kids better? Number three, how can I make you feel more secure? Financially, physically, whatever. What can I do to make you feel secure? What dreams do you have? And how can I help you achieve them? It's not all about me. It's not all about my career. It's not all about my job. What do you want to do? You've been doing the same thing for 5 years. What do you want to do? We'll make it happen. I'm on your team. How can I help you? So, gentlemen, love your wife as Christ loved the church. Maybe here's a good question. Is your wife's life better for having you in it? Ask her. Don't be afraid of the answer and don't justify it. Listen to what she has to say and then make changes appropriately. Don't act off of emotions. Develop a plan and stick to it. I'm telling you, putting these few things into your life and it will make sure that you do not have near as many regrets as you might have in the future, and it will ensure a home that glorifies your Heavenly Father, and your children will get to see what it looks like to be loved and to love well. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for your words, and thank you for humbling me, knowing that I fail daily at every single one of these things, but your grace knows no bounds. It's inexhaustible. And so, Father, thank you so much for that. I pray that you would work in and through each and every one of our lives as we step out into this world and put these things into practice. I love you, and I ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, guys, some of you, we mentioned this at the beginning, but you might have been coming in a little late. Real quickly, we're providing 20 Thanksgiving meals for people in our community. We've never done this before, and we need your help for it. When you leave today, you'll get a card per family, and the card looks like that, and it tells you what we need you to bring. So it'd be really awesome if you brought a box, and inside that box was a frozen turkey, stuffing mix, instant potatoes, mac and cheese, canned yams, all that stuff, and we're going to go take it to somebody. We're partnering with the Salvation Army, who's done a fantastic job at providing and vetting and getting us people who have real needs in our community, and so we're going to go take care of that. So make sure you get one of those cards and bring it back. Everything's on there. Bring it back on the 20th. Don't go get it right now and say, what do you want me to do with a frozen turkey? Wait till the 20th, okay? We need it then, and then we're going to give it out on the 21st on that Monday. And so if you want to be with us as we do that, go hand it to people and pray for them. You can do that as well. Next slide, real quickly. The angel tree is coming, okay? So we're going to have 40 kids on an angel tree in this room. It's going to be right back here, and we want you to be a part of that as well. Last thing, download our app. Our app has the top three every single week. When you open the app, it'll have the top three things you need to know about what's going on at Bainbridge Church. So make sure you download the app, download the app, download the app. Please, please, please download the app. It's got everything. All right. I love you guys. We'll see you out in the halls. Have a great week.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. Within your presence, I speak Jesus.